podcast is part of the Deluxe Edition Network. To find other great shows on the network, head over to deluxeeditionnetwork.com. That's deluxeeditionnetwork.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Films and Fermentation. This is episode 165. That's right, we are Films and Fermentation, a movie and alcohol podcast. I'm Leo.
I'm Mike.
No Kevin. For anybody who's like a regular listener out there, Kevin couldn't join us this week. Hopefully he'll be with us on the next episode. I'll let him explain to you why he was absent this evening. So Mike and I are doing the old buddy cop thing tonight and just doing the show with the two of us.
Just the two of us.
We can make it if we try. So tonight we are doing a tribute to James Earl Jones, the legendary actor and the legendary voice who passed away recently. We're three friends who like talk shit about movies while getting shit faced. Tonight we're only two friends talking shit about movies while getting shit faced. And as I said in this episode, we will raise a glass to the voice of a galaxy far, far away. Right, folks, we're honoring the iconic James Earl Jones, the man who can make even your grocery list sound like Shakespeare. Whether he was ruling the Pride Lands, reminiscing about America's pastime, or striking fear into the hearts of rebels, his voice was the soundtrack of our lives. So pour yourself a drink as smooth as his baritone and join us in celebrating a true cinematic giant. This one's for you, Mr. Jones. Don't forget to drop us an email at filmsoffermentation@gmail.com or visit linktree.com/filmsoffermentation. Find all of our social media and podcast links. Become part of the Films of Fermentation family by supporting us on Patreon or buying our merchandise at teespring.com. We are currently part of the Deluxe Edition Network, The Den, at deluxeeditionnetwork.com. Check out Podcast of the Month for September, The Church of Tarantino. And before we move on with the episode, I just would like to once again thank our guest on our previous episode, Cthulhu Jack, who came on episode 164, Films the Time Forgot. Very intriguing guest, very fun guy to interview, had a lot to say about a lot of different movies. Guessed mine right away, which was both impressive and upsetting. And I am so happy he was able to join us, and I hope he comes on again, because that episode currently sits as the second most downloaded episode in our catalog right now.
Wow.
With the potential to possibly be number one day if we get a few more downloads. So,
wow.
Thanks again to Cthulhu Jack.
Yeah, thanks, Jack.
Yeah. So, Mike, what are we drinking tonight?
I am drinking a local favorite. I am drinking Yingling Oktoberfest.
Nice. I haven't had Yingling in a while. It's been a while since I've had Yingling. I read an article the other day that said that September is Bourbon Appreciation Month. And I said, well, I must be ahead of the game because I appreciate bourbon every month.
Every month.
So in honor of Bourbon Appreciation Month, and our, like I said, our previous guest, Cthulhu Jack, who is also a bourbon man, I am drinking bourbon tonight. I am drinking from a place here in Jersey, the Independent Spirits Distillery, Independent Bourbon. There it is. It is 90 proof. 45% alcohol by volume, straight bourbon whiskey, handcrafted. This is bottle number 73, I think it says, in batch number 4 of barrel number 4. Like, they actually tell you, like, when and how they made it and all that, which is kind of cool. It is a really, really smooth bourbon. That's what I'm enjoying tonight. Mike, anything special happened this week?
This week in film. mystery. In 1951, a streetcar named Desire, a film directed by Elia Kazan. Elia Kazan. And based on a Tennessee Williams 1947 play of the same name starring Marlon Brando and Vivian Leigh, premieres at Warner Brothers Theater, New York City.
I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody instead of a bum, which is what I am.
Which is what I think everybody knows from that film, that speech. It's an excellent movie. It's Marlon Brando's first Oscar for Best Actor came in this film, and well deserved. It's got one of my favorite special effects, though, for early 50s movies. There's a scene where they're in the back of I'm a contender scene. They're in the back of this car. And, you know, back then they would film in the car and they would have like a thing playing in the window in the back that made it look like the road was moving.
Right.
I don't know if they couldn't afford it or there was something wrong with it, but so they had blinds on the back window that were pulled down. So all you saw was just like light coming in the car, but you didn't see what like was outside the car. It was kind of like their way of showing that the car was moving, but you really couldn't see what was outside of it. It was kind of funny.
Yeah, it works. Yeah,
it works. What's the next one you got there?
In 1953, the first movie in CinemaScope, The Robe, based on a book by Lloyd C. Douglas, directed by Henry Coaster, and starring Richard Burton and Gene Simmons, premieres.
This is one of the lesser known Bible related films. It's about the robe that they removed from Jesus after he was crucified.
That's because it doesn't have Charlton Heston in it.
No, yeah. The lesser known one. I actually have seen this one because my dad was a fan of this film and had me watch it when I was younger with him. And It's a good movie. It is a very lesser known because it's kind of a fictional take on what happened to the robe after it was removed from Jesus during the crucifixion.
Yeah, I've also seen it. It's kind of long and
a lot of those 1950s Bible epics were. So
yeah, but this one felt long.
we did the Ten Commandments on our Easter episode. Ten Commandments was 7 hours long.
Yes, but it didn't feel as long as the robe did sometimes.
It felt long to me when I was taking notes on it, trying to keep up with minute by minute updates. The next one here is a good one. This is funny.
In 1986, 3D short film Captain EO with Michael Jackson premieres at Disney theme parks.
I saw this at the in Disney, the actual short film.
I saw it. I mean, when they brought it back.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
It's a weird one. What, quick trivia for you. Who's the villain?
God, I've only watched it once.
Joe Pesci.
Oh, yes, it is. You're right.
Joe Pesci was the villain in Captain EO.
Oh, I get Adrian is like, you know, get going googly over it because it's something from her childhood. You know, I came out and I went, what respecting crew would follow Mike Jackson? Oh yeah.
I can't remember the song. There's a song. I mean, there was a bunch of songs in the movie, but there was the one that I remember seeing the video for on MTV all the time, and it had Joe Pesci in the video. Oh, it was Smooth Criminal. Because there's like scenes from the film in that mm-hmm. video. So that's how I was first introduced to it. And then I actually saw it when I went to Disney. And it was probably like the early 90s or something. So we go from Disney and wholesome to this.
In 1987, film thriller Fatal Attraction, directed by Adrian Lynn, starring Michael Douglas and Glenn Close, is released.
This is the movie they should show to any man who thinks about cheating on his wife. If you love your pet rabbit.
Exactly.
Don't get your end wet with Glenn Close. Next one's a good one.
1990 American gangster film Goodfellas, directed by Martin Scorsese, starring Robert De Niro, Joe Pesci, and Ray Liotta premieres.
I keep going back to what is Scorsese's best film? And there's so many great ones, but I think Goodfellas is, we haven't done Scorsese. We should cover him one day.
Yeah.
Because like I love The Departed, I love Raging Bull, I love Taxi Driver, but like I keep coming back to Goodfellas because I think I've probably seen this more than any of his other films. It's just such a perfect gangster film, and should not have lost Best Picture to Dances with Wolves that year. I'm sorry.
It was based on a true story, so
it was based on a true story. The book that was based on about Henry Hill was actually called Wise Guys, but they changed the name of the film to Goodfellas because there was already another movie called Wise Guys that came out like 10 years before this.
Yeah, but can you actually think about who wrote the book and what it was about? It was probably loosely based on what really happened.
I'm sure, like, there's, like, he never mentions killing anybody in the book or in the film, but I'm sure he probably took a life or two.
I'm sure.
Considering the people he worked for, but yeah, I know there was a lot of things that were, you know, embellished a little bit, but it's still a good movie.
Yeah.
Next one.
1996, Paramount Pictures release cult revenge comedy, The First Wives Club, starring Bette Midler, Goldie Hawn, and Diane Keaton, and directed by Hugh Wilson.
Yep. Not seen this. Even I know Diane of the film. I know of the film. I know the big musical number in it. But I have never actually watched the film. I know my wife has. And we got one more.
Yep, in 1998, Rush Hour, directed by Burt Ratner, starring Jackie Chan and Chris Tucker, is released. Jackie Chan's Hollywood breakthrough.
So, yeah, he was a already a legend in China, and his first American release was a Chinese language film that was released, dubbed, and subtitled in America, which was Rumble in the Bronx, and
exactly.
Funny movie. Great action sequences, but this is the one where he tried to speak English for the first time.
There's a lot of words coming out your mouth.
There's a lot of fun bloopers online of him like screwing up his lines because he was still learning English at the time. I like the first one. I'm not a fan of two or three.
I don't think I watched three. I think I saw two. I didn't like one.
I liked one. It was okay. Do you have any must-try beer or craft destination for this evening, sir?
I have a must-try beer. This is Tundra Berry Fruit Ale from Tommy Knocker Brewery, Idaho Springs, Colorado. Here's a berry ale that's a special treatment to strip out gluten. Perhaps that process also broke down some of the unfermentable dextrins in the beer because it's nearly gushes, but eventually settles down with a slightly hazy reddish pink color with piles of white foam. Raspberry is the prominent taste with strawberry and some distant blackberry. It's very fresh and natural smelling. The palate is fruity and soft, forwardly sweet, and devoid of any expected tartness. At 4.7 ABV, this is an easy drinking malt based fruit punch that's great as a light dessert beer.
A dessert beer?
A dessert beer.
Dessert beer. All right. Normally at this time, we would do beer news is good news, but since Kevin's not here this evening, we don't have a beer news segment. Although
Do beer news?
I'm going to say that the next time he comes on, he might have some beer news is good news for us. Hint, hint, wink, wink.
I should text him why he didn't do beer news this week.
He has some good news, I'm sure.
I'm sure.
So we're going to take a quick break with an ad read from Coffee Brothers. And then when we come back, we're going to go to our main segment, which is a tribute to the career of the great, the iconic James Earl Jones. We'll be right back.
I love a good beer, but right now, I can use a good cup of coffee.
Have you heard about Coffee Brothers?
Oh, yeah. They're that coffee company out of New York, right?
Well, they're more like a coffee wizards of New York City. They source these amazing seasonal blends and single origin coffees. It's like a flavor adventure in every cup. And get this, they roast everything in small batches. None of that mass-produced stuff. It's like each bean gets the VIB treatment.
VIB?
Very important bean.
Hmm. Sounds fancy, but is it worth it?
Definitely. Plus, they're a two-person team. I mean, that's dedication right there. Two brothers, one mission to caffeinate the world. And right now, you can save 10% on your order. I mean, who doesn't love a good discount?
All right, you've convinced me. Let's get some Coffee Brothers now.
Coffee Brothers, where every cup is a sip of perfection. Save 10% on your next order with the code FNF10. That's FNF10. Cheers to great coffee. So thank you for sticking with us after those quick words from Coffee Brothers. We're moving on to our main segment, a little tribute to James Earl Jones, who passed away last week at the age of 93. A few little facts about his life before we get into his career. He, of course, is known for his deep voice, which has been used in many roles, including Darth Vader in Star Wars and Mufasa in The Lion King. He is one of only 14 people to achieve what is known as the EGOT. He has an Emmy, a Grammy, and a Tony. He never actually won an Academy Award, but he did receive an honorary Academy Award for his total body of work. So officially, he's considered an EGOT winner, although some people contest that since it wasn't actually a acting Oscar that he won. But I said, who cares? He's James Earl Jones.
Exactly.
James Earl Jones's career included many roles in film, television, and theater. He actually acted on stage in Othello, Hamlet, Coriolanus, and King Lear, all Shakespeare plays, as well as Fences, On Golden Pond, and Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. He narrated the opening of Third Rock from the Sun sitcom and voiced CNN's tagline, "This is CNN." He also participated in test films for Sesame Street back in the 1960s. What do you think? Was he Big Bird, Snuffleupagus? Was he was he playing on Sesame Street?
It says here, Lemming number 30. His IMDb account.
He was, no, I thought he was going to try out for Grover, you know. Nia. Fa.
He's the count.
Ha, ha, ha. Jones was born in Arkabootla, Mississippi on January 17th, 1931. He actually had a stutter as a child, which he said he used both acting and poetry to help him overcome. He served in the U.S. Army during the Korean War as an officer in the Reserve Officers Training Corps. He often used primal therapy to help him release repressed childhood traumas. He would scream inside of a soundproof chamber that he had built into his own home. He was married to actor Julianne Moore and then later to Cecilia Hart, with whom he had one son, Flynn Earl Jones. And those are just some quick facts about James Earl Jones. I knew about the stuttering thing.
Yeah.
It was pretty fascinating that, you know, what we know him for is what kind of helped him, you know, get through that, which is pretty cool. So he has done so many things.
Yeah.
In his career, if you look at his IMDb, it is extensive. You know, aside from stage work that he has done a lot of television.
A lot of television.
I'm looking here. I'm on IMDb now. He has 190 acting credits. Many of those, as I said, were TV shows, especially early in his career before getting some film roles. But his voice is used in a lot of different things, like the Star Tours adventure in Disney World.
Mm-hmm.
He actually said in his will, he gave Disney permission to continue to use his voice for future Star Wars products.
So then that way they would always have the consistency of his voice as Darth Vader. But yeah, man, I mean, he was in a million things. Some movies I even like missed as I was going through this. Like what I did was I picked out 12 movies that I thought, or 11 movies rather, that I thought were his most iconic, or were ones that, you know, didn't get as much attention as they should. But there are so many other ones that I couldn't use them all. There's just so many.
Yeah, there's
190 credits.
A lot.
A lot of TV, especially there. So he started in the 50s or 60s, looks like, on television, 1962, before getting his first film role in 64, and then did some more TV until 1970, when he did two movies, one of which he earned an Oscar nomination for. So let's hop into this list here. So his first major film role, or at least the first major film that he appeared in, was 1964's Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb, the Stanley Kubrick dark comedy classic satire, in which mm-hmm. he played Lieutenant Lothar Zog. He was the pilot of the ship that was dropping the atomic bomb. It's almost like a blink and you'll miss it kind of role, but it is the first major film that he ever appeared in. So he here has a lot is, of that too. Yeah. He does a lot of cameos movies, especially later in his career. So here's a little clip from Dr. Strangelove.
DSO ready.
Bombardier ready, sir.
Bomb fusing master safety on. Electronic, barometric, time, and impact.
Bomb fusing master safety's on. Electronic, barometric, time, and impact.
Fuse for ground burst. Delay factor, yellow 3.
Fuse for ground burst. Delay factor, yellow 3.
Bomb fusing circuits 1 through 4 test.
Bomb fusing circuits 1 through 4 test. Lights on.
Bomb arming test lights on 1 through 4.
Bomb arming test lights on 1 through 4.
Engage primary trigger switch override.
Primary trigger switch override. Engage.
Track indicators to maximum deflection.
Track indicators to maximum deflection.
Detonator set to zero altitude.
Detonator set to zero altitude.
Release first safety. First safety release.
First safety.
Release second safety. Second safety release.
Second safety.
What's funny is, so that's a scene that ultimately leads to Slim Pickens riding the bomb.
Yeah, well,
waving his hat in the air. But it's funny hearing him in that scene because, you know, he's obviously very young and his voice almost sounds a little bit higher.
A little bit.
I mean, still got that smooth baritone to it, but it sounds like it got a little bit deeper as he got older. Of course, as most of our voices do. His next major film role didn't come until 1970 when he was in a film called The Great White Hope, where he played Jack Jefferson. This is a movie loosely based on the life of Jack Johnson, who was the first black man to win the boxing world heavyweight championship. So in the film, he plays his character as the first African-American man to win the championship. He is, you know, oppressed upon because of this, because it's a white man's sport. He is nearly arrested for marrying a white woman, which was illegal at the time. Ended up having to move to Europe to try to escape the persecution. Ultimately coming back to the United States and being acquitted of the charges so long as he dropped the championship to a white boxer. So it was basically like a setup, you know, and he ultimately ends up dropping the championship, which is why the film is called Great White Hope. This right. is the only film he was ever nominated for Best Actor, which I can't believe that, but it's an interesting movie to see him in because he's very young, very handsome, and very built in this film because he was playing a boxer. So here's a little clip of Great White Hope.
Yeah, I want to see my little old mama.
Fried chicken, Jack.
Ooh, can't wait.
One more question. Yeah, go ahead.
Now, you're the first black man in the history of the ring who's ever had a crack at the heavyweight title. Now, white folks, of course, are behind Brady. I mean, he's the redeemer of the race and so on. But you, Jack Jefferson, are you the black hope?
Well, I'm black and I'm hoping.
Answer him straight, Jack.
Say, look, man, I ain't fighting for no race. I ain't redeeming nobody. My mama told me Mr. Lincoln done that. Ain't that why you shot him?
My, oh, my.
Some great lines in that scene, man.
Is that why you shot him?
I ain't fighting for my race. You guys, Lincoln did that already. And that why you shot him? Or like when they're like, "Do you think you're the great black hope?" He goes, "Well, I'm black and I got hope." It's a good movie. It's a really good movie. That's one I've saw. I think I was in college, early college, first time I saw that film, because I saw it in a film like theory class, and it's a really, really good movie. The next one I have on here, I love this one, and I love this role because it's such an offbeat role for him. Not just that it's a villain, like he has played villains before, but it's just such a weird villain for him to be playing.
Snake, like
opposite Arnold Schwarzenegger. So if you haven't guessed it yet and you haven't seen this movie, check it out. 1982's Conan the Barbarian, early Schwarzenegger film, in which James Earl Jones appears as the villain in the film.
Only real actor in the movie.
Yeah, the only real actor in the movie. He plays Thulsa Doom. It's also such a great character name, too. Thulsa Doom. So in the film, he is responsible for the death of Conan's parents when he's a child. He raises Conan, which is why he's such a big, beefy, muscular guy at the end of the film. And he becomes the leader of this sort of like religious cult that follows him without question. And so the scene that I picked out from this is probably his best scene in the film. It's called The Riddle of Steel.
Yes,
this is a great scene. So we're going to take a look at this one real quick. This is Conan the Barbarian. James Earl Jones as Thulsa Doom.
He raised that snake from the time it was born.
You killed my mother. You killed my father. You killed my people. You took my father's sword.
It must have been when I was younger. There was a time, boy, when I searched for steel. And steel meant more to me than gold or jewels.
The riddle of steel.
Yes. You know what it is, don't you, boy? Shall I tell you? It's the least I can do. Steel isn't strong, boy. Flesh is stronger. Look around you. There, on the rocks, that beautiful girl.
Come to me, my child.
That is strength, boy. That is power. The strength and power of flesh. What is steel compared to the hand that wields it? Look at the strength of your body, the desire in your heart. I gave you this.
I feel like I need to watch Conan again.
I do.
I so gave awesome. You this. I gave you this. The long hair kills me.
Bangs, yeah.
Bangs. Steel is not strong, boy. Flesh is stronger. That is a great death scene in that film, too. The next one I put on here, because it's such an odd one, man. It's such a film that you can't get away with nowadays.
Oh, yeah.
Movies from 1986. The film's called Soul Man. Stars James Earl Jones and C. Thomas Howell. C. Thomas Howell plays a man who realizes he can get a scholarship if he was black. So he pretends to be black by tanning his skin and putting Jerry Curl in his hair. I mean, come on now.
Well, you know, what was it, the 90s when they did White girls?
White chicks, yeah. both films, I think, would be a little hard to make nowadays. But this is a weird one. But
unless you're, you know, Robert Downey Jr.
Yeah, yeah. Then you get Oscar nominated for it. So this is the ultimately the scene in which C. Thomas Howe kind of learns his lesson and is confronted by James Earl Jones. So this is towards the end of the film.
You must have learned a great deal more than you bargained for through this experience, Mr. Watson.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Watson, a Harvard Law graduate can do a great many things. Make a lot of money. Teach. Become a senator. A judge. A Harvard Law graduate has power, Mr. Watson. I hope that I teach my students to use that power responsibly, even generously. But you've learned something that I can't teach them. You've learned what it feels like to be black.
No, sir.
Beg your pardon?
I don't really know what it feels like, sir. If I didn't like it, I could always get out. It's not the same, sir.
You've learned a great deal more than I thought.
Ooh, something really distinguished about bearded James Earl Jones.
Yeah.
He makes a movie that's otherwise insane and implausible, like, almost makes sense.
Almost gives it legitimacy.
Yeah. I mean, that scene right there was like, you take away the rest of the movie, which is kind of like a goofy 80s comedy, and you have a pretty compelling, like, dramatic scene there.
Got some depth to it. Geez.
Yeah. The next one here is, I don't know if anybody ever heard of this movie, this stinker of a film.
Yeah, but it's one of those movies you love to watch because you love bad movies.
Yeah. Total sarcasm there, folks, because this is one of the greatest goddamn movies ever made. 1987, he did this little film called Field of Dreams, where he played the reclusive author Terrence Mann, who was a stand-in for, oh my God, why can't I think of the writer's name? Catcher in the Rye, J.D. Salinger. So he was a stand-in for J.D. Salinger, who was the character in the book, but didn't want his likeness in the film. So they created this different character, Terrence Mann, but who's based on J.D. Salinger, and James Earl Jones, you know, pun intended, knocks it out of the park in this film about, you know, the magic of baseball.
And this fantasy will probably be our next week's episode as well.
For misquotes?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we'll talk about that a little later. But yeah, we're going to do some movie misquotes next time around. And I think the misquote here is, if you build it, he will come.
Or was it they will come?
I think it's if he builds it, they will come, or something like that. I don't remember exactly, but yeah, that's like a very misquoted line. But that's not what I brought up here for James Earl Jones. What I brought up here for James Earl Jones is just such a magnificent scene and such baseball. A great monologue. That's right. It is the baseball scene. Baseball, America's pastime. So here we go.
Ray, people will come, Ray. They'll come to Iowa for reasons they can't even fathom. They'll turn up your driveway, not knowing for sure why they're doing it. They'll arrive at your door, as innocent as children, longing for the past. Of course, we won't mind if you look around, you'll say. It's only $20 per person. They'll pass over the money without even thinking about it. For it is money they have, and peace they like.
Ray. Just sign the papers.
And they'll walk out to the bleachers. Sit in shirt sleeves on a perfect afternoon. They'll find they have reserved seats somewhere along one of the baselines. where they sat when they were children and cheered their heroes. And they'll watch the game, and it'll be as if they'd dipped themselves in magic waters. The memories will be so thick, they'll have to brush them away from their faces.
Ray, when the bank opens in the morning, they'll foreclose.
People will come, Ray.
You're broke, Ray. You sell now or you lose everything.
The one constant through all the years, Ray, has been baseball. America has rolled by like an army of steamrollers. It's been erased like a blackboard, rebuilt and erased again. But baseball has marked the time. This field, this game, is a part of our past, Ray. It reminds us of all that once was good and it could be again. Oh, people will come, Ray. People will most definitely come.
I got chills. Seen that movie a million times and gives me chills every time, man. I love that scene.
This way he says baseball.
Baseball. Be as if they were, they dipped their toes in magic water. I decided, you know, like when at a person's funeral, they often play like, you know, the pictures on the TV of like their life and stuff. Mm-hmm. I don't want my life played on the TV. My life's not that interesting. I want all my favorite movie scenes played during my funeral. Oh, God, Field of Dreams. From that, we go to a little different role. 1988, he plays the character King Jaffe Jafar in Coming to America, the Eddie Murphy comedy film. I couldn't find a really good clip for this one. The best I can get is he comes to America looking for his son and is appalled to find out that his son is working. Wait, do I even have that on here? Sandlot, Sneakers, Great White Hope, first movie role. I don't even have that on here, so never mind.
Okay.
Oh, no, I forgot to put that one on the list, but that's not a big deal. Well, Coming to America, like his role in Coming to America is fairly small. The next one I put on here is probably like a lesser known one, but it cracks me up because if you hear the basis for it, it's just so weird. The film is 1989's Best of the Best, starring James Earl Jones, Eric Roberts, and Chris Penn.
Yeah, it's a fight movie.
It's about the American karate team.
Yeah.
Going to fight in an international karate tournament. Mm-hmm. And their coach, Frank Kuzo, is played by James Earl Jones.
Oh, Eric Roberts is nothing but has nothing but karate roles. So
I just say to myself, like I love James Earl Jones, but you know, I don't really think him when I think karate. So here's a quick clip of him giving a speech to his team before the tournament.
I'll say this only once. A team is not a team if you don't give a damn about one another. You are now members of the U.S. National Karate Team. You represent the United States of America. Remember that, and we will accomplish our objective. Our only objective, which is to win.
Is to win.
What was that about lending legitimacy to movies? The only thing he does in that movie is lend some legitimacy to it. Speaking of legitimate films, this is definitely a legitimate one. This is 1990's The Hunt for Red October. He has a fairly small role in there. What's that? Yeah, I was not here. So he has a very small role in this as Admiral Greer. But yeah, this is a great scene because this is the scene that you were just mentioning, Mike.
I was never.
Seahawk 1, this is Bravo Command. He He's ready. Seahawk 1, release on my command. Drop. Now, now, now. Range to target, 900 yards. 800 yards. 700 yards. 600 yards. 500 yards. 400 yards. 300 yards. Torpedo is detonated.
No. You understand, Commander? That torpedo did not self-destruct. You heard it hit the hull, and I was never here. Contact Dallas. Give him the go.
I forgot how many stars are in that damn movie.
Oh, man, that movie is crazy. You got Alec Baldwin. You got him. You got Tim Curry, Sean Connery, Sam Neill. Jeffrey Jones was in that scene in the background.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people in that film. But directed by one of my favorite directors, the guy that did Die Hard. McTiernan, John McTiernan.
Yeah.
I feel like I need to rewatch all the movies on this list. Maybe mine is Best of the Best and Soul Man. I need to kind of go through this. I already rewatched Sneakers after we did that on last week's episode. So. and speaking of that, that's the next one on my list. 1992's Sneakers, where he plays Mr. Bernard Abbott. I think he's what, the FBI in this film, or NSA, something like that.
Something like that, yeah.
But it's basically a cameo role where he appears at the very end of the film to
pretty confront much what he did in Red October.
Yeah, kind of the same thing. Like, I was never here. But this is a great scene. So this is his cameo appearance at the end of Sneakers.
What do you want, Mr. Bishop?
Clear up my record. Get out of my life.
I don't have much choice, do I?
Not unless you want to read about it in Newsweek.
Deal. The box.
Not so fast. I want a Winnebago.
What?
Fully equipped. Big kitchen, waterbed, AM/FM CD, microwave.
This is not a car dealership, pal.
He wants a Winnebago.
All right, a Winnebago.
Thank you. Burgundy interior.
Now the box.
I have never taken my wife to Europe.
I'm sorry to hear it. Give me the box.
You will buy me 2 round-trip first-class tickets to Athens, Lisbon, Madrid, and Scotland.
Don't forget Tahiti.
And Tahiti.
Tahiti is not in Europe.
Excuse me. When you get the box, then you give us geography lessons. Until then, this man goes to Tahiti.
Fine. Tahiti.
Carl?
The young lady with the Uzi. She single.
All right, yeah, Carl, excuse us.
Yeah.
This is the brass ring. Now you gotta think bigger thoughts.
I just want a telephone number.
Please. How about a lunch? You can chaperone.
No, I will not do this.
Hey, Abby, come on. Now, the FBI'd give him twins.
No!
Wait a second. You can have anything you want, and you're asking for my phone number.
Yes.
2739164. Area code 415.
I'm Carl.
I'm Mary.
I'm going to be sick. Are we done here?
No, not yet. Whistler.
I want peace on earth and goodwill toward men.
Oh, this is ridiculous.
He's serious.
I want peace on earth and goodwill toward men.
We are the United States government. We don't do that sort of thing.
Just gonna have to try.
I like the last two.
You know, as going to be sick with the U.S. government. We don't do that sort of thing. No, I like Redford's line. Abby, come on. The FBI would give them twins. It's something so mesmerizing about seeing James Earl Jones, Robert Redford, and Sidney Poitier in the same scene together. It's just like overwhelming.
Well, that's another whole cast of characters. Jesus.
We talked about that last week. Like, it's one of those ensemble films. It's just ridiculous. Like, aside from those three, you had Ben Kingsley, Dan Aykroyd, David Strathairn, Mary McDonald, River Phoenix, Timothy Busfield. I mean, there is it's just endless row of names in that film. But I love Sneakers. Such a great movie. Next one is, I think, a classic as far as, like, if you're, you know, grew up in the 90s, it's definitely a classic. It's a very coming of age film. 1993's The Sandlot. His next go around in a movie about baseball, in which this one he plays Mr. Myrtle, the blind guy that owns the junkyard where the kids play baseball all the time. And this is the scene where they confront him for the first time. Another great cameo scene from James Earl Jones at the end of the film.
You in trouble, aren't you, son?
Yeah, well, that was my stepdad's ball. I took it without asking. It was signed by Babe Ruth.
George signed this?
George Herman Ruth? Yeah.
I take it back. You're not in trouble. You're dead where you stand. Hold on. Here. I'll trade you.
That's really nice of you, but that ball really is signed by Babe Ruth.
So is this one. With the rest of the 1927 Yankees.
Man. Reverse Row. Lou Gehrig.
Babe Ruth! But why would you trade? That one's all chewed up.
I got a lot of good stuff. Look at that stuff. Besides, you need it more than I do.
You knew Babe Ruth?
George? I sure did. And he knew me. He was almost as great a hitter as I was. I would have broken his record, too, but...
You went blind.
Yep. I used to crowd the plate so that strike zone almost disappeared. Pitchers hate that. That's the way I played. 100% all the time. Baseball was life. And I was good at it. Real good. And then, one day, a high fast one and pow, the lights went out.
I don't think we could take this ball.
I tell you what. You guys come by here once a week and talk baseball with me. We'll call it an even trade.
Deal!
Even though Bill...
It's the way he says certain words. I used to crowd the plate so that the strike zone almost disappeared.
George!
George, I knew him and he knew me. That's a great. I would love to visit a James Earl Jones once a week and talk about baseball. Exactly. The next one here is 1994's adaptation of the Shakespeare film Hamlet. One of my favorites.
What's that? Scene in this movie, Lion King, where, you know, they have the song "He Lives in You." Playing, and I tear up on that one. Now that he's dead, I'm gonna freaking bawl when that scene comes in. You know?
Well, I chose for this the appearance of Mufasa's ghost to speak to Simba about knowing who he is.
That's right before he lives in you.
Yeah, right before he lives in you. Like, there's so many great scenes you can do from this movie, but this is one of my favorites. One of the ones I used to show when I used to teach Hamlet in high school all the time. I would show this scene in comparison to the ghost scene in Hamlet.
You knew my father?
Correction. I know your father.
I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Nope. Wrong again.
He's alive. And I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki. He knows the way. Come on. Don't dawdle. Hurry up!
Hey, whoa, wait.
Come on. Come on!
Would you slow down?
Stop!
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Forgotten me. Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No! Please, don't leave me.
Remember.
Father.
Remember.
Don't leave me.
Remember.
Now, I always got, like, Star Wars vibes whenever he says, you are my son. But, just the first time, and I've seen his movie, goddamn, so many times, I got another Star Wars vibe from it. When Rafiki is leading him through the jungle to the pool, I got real Empire Luke going through the jungle to face himself vibes from it. Which you could kind of say is probably why they got him to do the voice of Mufasa. You holding up? You all right there, Mike? You tearing up or are you good?
I'm all right.
You all right?
Well, I have a lot of similarities to, you know, Simba.
Mm-hmm. And I know. I love The Lion King. Such a classic. Yeah, I got to start going through this list and rewatching some of these movies. Yep. And then, of course, the last thing we have here is Star Wars. Probably the thing he's best known for. I didn't want to do all the Star Wars films. I mean, I think people mostly know, you know, that. But I kind of wanted to focus on some other movies, either lesser known or ones that don't get talked about enough from his career. But it would be a disservice to the legacy of James Earl Jones not to talk about Star Wars a little bit. So for this, I have a video here that is the 25 best Darth Vader quotes from the Star Wars saga. This is from all the films. This includes like Rogue One and the prequels and things like that. So here we go. The 25 greatest Darth Vader quotes.
Commander, tear this ship apart until you found those plans and bring me the passengers. I want them alive.
Lord Vader, the fleet has moved out of light speed and we're preparing to...
You have failed me for the last time, Admiral. Captain Piet.
Yes, my lord.
Make ready to land our troops beyond their energy field, then deploy the fleet so that nothing gets off the system. You are in command now, Admiral Piet.
Thank you, Lord Vader.
You may dispense with the pleasantries, Commander. I'm here to put you back on schedule.
I assure you, Lord Vader, my men are working as fast as they can.
Perhaps I can find new ways to motivate them.
I tell you, this station will be operational as planned.
The Emperor does not share your optimistic appraisal of the situation.
But he asks the impossible. I need more men.
Then perhaps you can tell him when he arrives.
The Emperor's coming here?
That is correct, Commander. And he is most displeased with your apparent lack of progress.
We shall double our efforts.
I hope so, Commander, for your sake. The Emperor is not as forgiving as I am. Out of this technological terror you've constructed, the ability to destroy a planet is insignificant next to the power of the Force. What is it, General?
My lord, the fleet has moved out of light speed. Comscan has detected an energy field protecting an area of the sixth planet of the Hoth system. The field is strong enough to deflect any bombardment.
The rebels are alerted to our presence. Admiral Ozzel came out of light speed too close to the system.
He felt surprised was wiser.
He is as clumsy as he is stupid. Leave them to me. I will deal with them myself.
You are part of the Rebel Alliance and a traitor. Take her away!
Apology accepted, Captain Nida.
And now, Your Highness, we will discuss the location of your hidden rebel base. Been waiting for you, Obi-Wan. We meet again at last. The circle is now complete. When I left you, I was but the learner. Now I am the master.
Your powers are weak, old man.
You are unwise to lower your defenses.
The damage we've sustained, they must have been destroyed.
No, Captain. They're alive. I want every ship available to sweep the asteroid field until they are found. Free to use any methods necessary, but I want them alive. No disintegrations.
As you wish.
You don't know the power of the dark side.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
All too easy. Perhaps you're not as strong as the Emperor thought. Impressive. Most impressive. What is thy bidding, my master?
I have you now.
Perhaps you think you're being treated unfairly?
No.
Good. It would be unfortunate if I had to leave a garrison here. I am altering the deal. Pray I don't alter it any further. There is no escape. Don't make me destroy you.
Yourself to the dark side.
I am your father.
No! I like that he included no.
That was it.
No!
Were they picking every line he did in the first three movies?
Yeah, I know. They missed one from Rogue One. There's a going in Rogue One where he's meeting with Krennic, and he's complaining that Tarkin's trying to take credit for the Death Star. Uh-huh. And Vader starts choking him, and he's like, be careful, Captain, don't choke on your ambitions. I think everybody knows, like, you know, you don't know the power of the dark side, and all the other lines like that are pretty popular.
Most.
I think my favorite line is I find your lack of faith disturbing. And I love the running joke in Empire where he keeps killing his admirals and then appointing the next guy as admiral before killing him too.
I think the emperor said for him to stop that. That's why he didn't kill anybody in Jedi.
Yeah. You're wiping out all of our officers. No disintegrations. So yeah, it wasn't fair to not include some Star Wars. I actually have another one I want to throw in here. So we don't normally talk about TV shows and stage plays and things like that on here, but like I said, he's done a lot of stage and television and stuff, and there were a few things that stood out that I wanted to add as like bonuses. One of those is the Obi-Wan series. Say what you want about the series. I know there's a lot of people who I've read online who are not a fan of the series in general, but they all seem to be in agreement that this one scene from Obi-Wan is amazing. And it is the battle between Anakin and Obi-Wan in the last episode, where you hear Hayden Christensen's voice and James Earl Jones's voice is kind of overlapping in this scene. And it's just such an amazing, you know, like dialogue. I just wanted to play that real quick. So this is from the 2022 Obi-Wan Kenobi series.
Anakin. Anakin's gone. I am what remains. I'm sorry, Anakin. For all of it. I am not your failure,
Obi-Wan.
You didn't kill Anakin Skywalker. I did. The same way I will destroy you.
Then my friend is truly dead. Goodbye, Darth.
I used to think the final battle between the two of them in Revenge of the Sith was like the pinnacle of the prequel films, because it's such a great fight scene and such an emotional ending. You know, with the "You're my brother, Anakin, I loved you," like all that stuff. Mm-hmm. I think that scene beats it.
That one. I know you haven't seen it, but the scene between Vader and Ahsoka in Clone Wars.
I haven't watched the series, but I've seen the scene.
In Rebels. Yeah.
Yeah, like that's a great scene. And even the one with him and Ahsoka in the Ahsoka series, the live action series, where she sees him in the other realm, it's pretty good. But in this scene here with Obi-Wan, it's like between the way the scene is lit by the lightsabers, the emotion, the dialogue, the overlapping voices, it's just so powerful. And I think it actually overpowers that last scene in Revenge of the Sith a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, it's such an amazing scene.
The lightsabers is lighting up his face.
Yeah. The way the scene's lit, it's phenomenal. You know, it even goes like red to blue with Obi-Wan as he's like realizing things. It's such a wonderful scene. Something I included here is a stage performance that is powerful. Most people might know Fences from the film that came out a couple years ago starring Denzel Washington. But the main character of the play Fences was originated by James Earl Jones. He was the first actor to play this character on stage. And so what I have here is a little clip of his performance in Fences on stage.
A memorable scene by James Earl Jones as a stern father who has struggled to build a life and keep control of his family shows him teaching his son a painful lesson about setting his expectations for affection.
Can I ask you a question?
What the hell you want to ask me? Mrs. DeWicke is the one you got the questions for.
How come you ain't never liked me?
Liked you? Who in the hell ever said, I got to like you? What law is there to say, I got to like you? Do you want to stand up in my face and ask me some damn fool-ass question like that? Talk about liking somebody. Come here, boy, when I talk to you. Straighten up, goddammit. Ask you a question. What law is there to say, I got to like you?
None.
All right, then. Don't you eat every day? Answer me when I talk to you. Don't you eat every day?
Yeah.
Nigga, as long as you live in my house, you put a sir on the end of it when you talk to me.
Yes, sir.
You eat every day.
Yes, sir.
Got a roof over your head.
Yes, sir.
And clothes on your back.
Yes, sir.
Why do you think that is?
Because of you.
Hell, I know it's because of me. Why do you think that is?
Because you like me.
Like you. I go out of here every morning and bust my butt putting up with them crackers all day long because I like you. You is the biggest fool I ever saw. It is my job. It is my responsibility. You understand that? A man got to take care of his family. You live in my house. You sleep your behind on my bedclothes. You put my food in your belly because you are my son. You are my flesh and blood, not because I like you. It is my duty to take care of you. I owe a responsibility to you. Wait now. Let's get this straight right now. But go along any further. I ain't got to like you. Mr. Rand, don't give me my money come payday because he liked me. He give me because he owe me. Now, I didn't give you everything I had to give you. I gave you your life. Your mama and me worked it out between us. And lacking your black ass was not a part of the bargain. And don't you try and go through life worried if somebody like you or not. You best make sure that they are doing right by you. You understand what I'm saying, boy?
Yes, sir.
Then you get the hell out of my face and go on down to A&P.
I would love to. Yeah, I gotta like you. I wish I could have seen James Earl Jones on stage performing anything. I would have liked to just sit and watch him read the phone book. Page one, Anderson. He was probably best known for his dramatic roles and his voice work and all that, but he could be a little fun from time to time too, and include making fun of himself in what was one of my favorite like final performances of his.
A guest spot
on the Big Bang Theory. This is actually not that scene where he's like, I like Star Wars too. This is a better scene, I think. I love this scene right here.
I don't understand what we're doing.
Shh.
Whose house is this?
Carrie Fisher. And she's a little crazy, so get ready to run.
Why am I laughing? Oh, man, and that was one of Carrie Fisher's final performances too.
Yeah,
sad. So I was reading a little behind the scenes thing on that episode, and they had never met in person until that Big Bang Theory episode. Because when he was recording the voice work for Darth Vader, he was in the sound booth by himself. Yeah. He was never on set. Mm-hmm. And so this is the first time they ever actually met in person. And he said when he met her backstage for the first time, she ran up to him and said, "Dad," and hugged him. So, yeah, that's such a great thing. So I got one more thing here. This is an appearance he made on the David Letterman show in the 90s. David Letterman used to do a top 10 list every night on his late night talk show. And this is the top 10 things that sound cool in James Earl Jones's voice, as given to us by James Earl Jones.
Okay. The category tonight from the home office, top 10 things that sound cool when spoken by James Earl Jones. Oh, the famous actor, a fine actor, a lovely man. Top 10 things that sound cool when spoken by James Earl Jones. James, nice to see you. Thank you very much.
He's in character.
Yeah, like that guy that was here earlier. Top 10 things that sound cool when spoken by James Earl Jones. Here we go, number 10.
I can't believe it's not butter.
No. Number 9.
Objects in mirror may be closer than they appear.
Number 8.
J-Lo in the house.
J-Lo in the house.
Yeah, that sounded cool.
Number 7.
Click here now for the hottest sex sites on the web.
Number 6.
And the Academy Award for Best Picture goes to... Dude, where's my car?
I like that. Number 5.
You're not fully clean until you're zestfully clean.
All right, fine. Number 4.
You mean I get all these great funk classics on just one CD or cassette.
Yeah. Number 3.
Number 3.
Well, now, wait a minute. That makes no sense at all. The number 2 cool thing when spoken by James Earl Jones.
Meow, 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 meow.
And the number 1 thing that sounds cool when spoken by James Earl Jones...
Wazza!
That's how you know it's from the 90s.
Wazza! Meow, 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 meow,
meow, meow, meow. Click here for the hottest sex sites on the web.
Number 3.
Mr. Jones, you will be missed. You were an icon, a legend. We still love all your movies, and we will keep watching them and keep the legend alive as much as we can, man. such a cool retrospective. Mike, you have any beer trivia or history for us this evening?
I got a fun beer fact for you. Ninkasi was the Sumerian goddess of beer and of alcohol. Born of sparkling fresh water, according to the text, she satisfied desires and sated the hearts. Nasaki's Brewing in Eugene, Oregon named their brewery after her.
All right. We got a couple cinema quotes of the week tonight. Cinema should make you forget you're sitting in the theater. I agree with that, even if I don't agree with the man who said it, Roman Polanski, who is quite a controversial figure in Hollywood history.
Yeah, but the quote's pretty
good. But it is a good quote. And we have a second quote tonight, and that's because since this episode was in honor of James Earl Jones, I threw a little James Earl Jones quote on here. I love to see actors work. I love to surf channels late at night and accidentally run into movies I hadn't seen before. It makes me very proud of the profession. And I like that quote because then you know that he's not just an actor for himself, he's an actor for others. He supports the people in his craft. Mike, how was your drink this evening?
Oh, very good. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I was drinking Yuengling's Oktoberfest.
I know. I haven't had that one in a while. I haven't had, like, their Oktoberfest, at least. And in honor of Bourbon Appreciation Month, and because I appreciate bourbon every month, I had some independent bourbon from Independent Spirits Distillery here in New Jersey. I feel really good because it is 90 proof, and I drank, I want to say at least 3 glasses of it right now. Thank God I don't. Oh, no, I do have to work tomorrow. But thank you again, everybody, for joining us tonight for episode 165, the tribute to James Earl Jones. We hope you enjoyed listening to the podcast as much as we enjoyed recording it for you. We may be back with a new episode in a week or so. We're not sure yet. It kind of depends on Kevin's schedule a little bit. We're hoping he rejoins us for the next episode. It might just be me and Mike again. We're not sure. But most likely we'll have another episode coming out soon. The next episode we're doing, episode 166, is called Movie Misquotes. We're going to talk about some of the most misheard quotes and lines from movies of all time. So don't forget to stop by the Crossroads Between Pickled and Fermented next time around. Again, you can email us at filmsandfermentation@gmail.com or go to linktree.com/filmsandfermentation to find all of our social media and podcast links. You can support us on Patreon. You can buy our merchandise at teespring.com. And make sure you continue to check out the YouTube channel of our new friend Cthulhu Jack at Cthulhu Jack Presents. Thanks again for appearing on our show last week. We really appreciate it. Again, hopefully we'll have a new episode in another week or so. We'll see. But, you know, we'll keep you informed, people. We always do. I'm Leo.
I'm Mike.
Kevin's not here again, but, you know, he's here with us in spirit, and he says hi, everybody. And I'm sure he can't wait to tell you why he wasn't on tonight's podcast.
Yeah.
But we'll save that for him. Anyway, this has been the Films and Fermentation Podcast. Thanks again for joining us. Cheers, everybody.
Cheers.